Candy from Epic Gaming Night, and today we're taking a look at the newest game from Gameling Games. It's not tiny at all, but it definitely is epic, and that's Heroes of Land, Air, and Sea. Let's take a look. Heroes of Land, Air, and Sea is a Fantasy 4X game where you will explore, expand, exploit, and exterminate your opponents on the field of battle. Each player will choose and play one of the four fantasy races: the dwarves, the orcs, the humans, or the elves. Each player starts the game with two serfs and a warrior, and they will take turns doing actions by the actions listed at the top of their player board. There'll be two actions each round, and then after everybody has done their two actions, you'll collect resources. Let's take a look at the command action side of the board. So the first command action we're going to look at is March. This allows you to move an army of up to 5 units from one space on the board to another. The max movement is determined by the slowest unit in that army based off of their speed, which is noted in the compass symbol on that unit on your player board. If you end in a space with an exploration token, you'll flip that token over and look at the reference sheet to see exactly what that does. There are all kinds of different exploration tokens you can encounter. Majority of the time, these aren't too negative as long as you have the correct resources when you go and encounter it. The next command action is Sail. This allows you to move your sea vessels around the board, and they can move through the different sea spaces carrying with them units up to their capacity level. The next command action is Fly. This allows you to move your flying units. These units can go across sea areas, but cannot end their movement in them. They can also move up to their speed and can carry units up to their capacity level. The last action is Cast. This will allow you to cast a non-combat spell. You'll pay the amount of magic required to cast the spell in the upper left-hand corner, and you will also gain the victory points in the upper right-hand corner and do the ability on the spell. There are all kinds of different spells in Heroes of Land, Air, and Sea that you can cast to turn the tides into your favor. Immediately after completing a command action, you can do another command action if you use one of your serfs, and you can place them on one of the other commands that you haven't already used this round. This allows you to double up on actions during your turn. Now let's take a look at the capital actions. The first capital action is Recruit. This allows you to pay resources to bring one unit in from your reserves onto your capital city. At the beginning of the game, you can only recruit serfs and warriors, but as you unlock different buildings, you can gain heroes and different vehicles into your army, which are much more powerful and have all sorts of different special abilities. The next capital action is the Build action, where you can build one of three different things. The first is you can spend 3 ore and 1 serf to build a building on your player board. This will unlock new special abilities and allow you to use the hero or vehicle listed below. You'll also gain more special abilities with each building you have as your capital level increases. The next thing you can do is upgrade your capital level. You do this by spending the correct number of resources and then putting the structure on top of your capital. This will unlock several different things, including improved defenses, as well as being able to hold extra spell cards in your hand, as well as unlocking new special abilities based on the buildings you currently have. The last thing you can build are towers. Towers cost 1 ore per space away from your capital city. So this tower would cost you 2 ore to build because it's 2 spaces away. Towers can also be used as adjacent spaces to your capital city, which can make it a lot easier to move your units around the board. They also are worth 1 point per space away from your capital city. So if you get one behind enemy lines, not only can you move your troops in, they're worth a ton of points. The next capital action is Research. This allows you to do one of two different actions. You can either draw 3 spells from the spell deck and keep a number of spells up to your capital level, or you can scribe one of your spells. This will allow you to save one of your spells, so whenever you use the cast action, you can cast a scribe spell, and then it will take 2 turns to be able to cast that spell again, but then you can continually cast it without having to discard it as long as you wait in between rounds. The last capital action is tax. This allows you to get some bonus resources by using the tax action. You'll gain resources equal to the current number on the tax board. So if you gained magic here, you would gain 4 magic. And then the tax board will rotate for the next time a player chooses tax. Anytime a player chooses a capital action, any other player on the board may choose to follow that capital action by spending one of their serfs on that capital action. So if another player researches, you can then also research. Or if another player builds, you can then also build. Each of these can only be done once a turn, but having the correct amount of serfs can allow you to get a bunch of extra actions in a round. After all players have taken turns placing their 2 action markers, then all the players will gather resources based on their units in different locations. Each unit in a location will gain you 1 resource of that type. This warrior will gain you 1 magic. If a serf is in a specific type of area, they will gain you an extra resource if they are in the circle in that area. So this serf will gain you 2 ore. Then, if there are 2 circles in the area, you can put 2 serfs in there and gain extra resources. So these 2 serfs will gain you 3 food. Then you calculate how many resources you gain altogether with all of your units on the board and increase your resources on your resource track. Then players clear their action board and pass the first player token and begin a new round. All of the heroes in Heroes of Land, Air, and Sea have their own unique special abilities. They have 3 different ones, and they'll start with their level 1 and will unlock their level 2 and level 3 based on your capital city level. So as you upgrade your civilization, your heroes become more powerful. Now let's take a look at combat. Whenever you end a movement in the same space as an opposing player's units, a combat begins. Each player's units have different strength based on the type of unit they are. At the beginning of combat, each player will calculate the strength of all of their combined units, and then they will choose 1 of the 7 different tactic cards for combat. These cards will add strength to your units during the combat. They also have a cost requirement to be able to play them into combat. They also have different counters, so if one player plays a specific card, certain cards will counter them and get extra strength against that specific card. So it's very much a mind game of trying to figure out what your opponent's playing and what their resources are to figure out what chances they have of playing different cards. After both players have secretly selected them, they will reveal them and determine the winner. The player with the highest combat number wins the combat, and the attacker will gain 1 victory point for starting the combat, and then both players will gain victory points off of their card after they have paid the cost for playing it. The loser will destroy 1/2 of their units back to their reserve, and the other 1/2 will be returned to their capital city. The 4 different factions in the base set play very differently. The dwarves are all about building buildings and taking over mountains. The orcs are all about raiding and pillaging and getting all the attacks in. Then the humans are all about being able to control planes and get more units out on the board. And the elves are all about casting magic spells and ways to control forests. Heroes comes with all sorts of awesome miniatures and structures for the factions. Let's take a closer look. A game of Heroes of Land, Air, and Sea will end if one of the four in-game conditions is met. The game will end if somebody gets all of their peons and warriors out onto the board. The game will also end if someone reveals the very last land exploration token on the board. Or if a player is able to successfully win a combat at a player's capital city. Or if a player is able to get all three of their towers out onto the board, remembering that you can only have one tower per continent, and you have to be at level 3 in your capital to build all three towers. If any of these conditions are met, the game ends at the end of the round, and then you do final game scoring. You'll gain points based on the units that you currently have on the board. You'll gain 1 point for each building. You'll gain points based off of the level of your capital city. You'll gain 1 point for each scribed spell, and you'll also gain points for each area you control on the board. Each faction also has some special ways that they can gain points based off of specific abilities unlocked by that faction. You tally up the points, the player with the most points is victorious. Overall, Heroes of Land, Air, and Sea is a fast-playing fantasy 4X game where you get to build your civilization from the ground up, having epic combats and building all sorts of upgrades to your civilization, putting units out on the board, gathering resources, and exploring different areas of the map. You can definitely expect a lot of epicness from Heroes of Land, Air, and Sea. Heroes of Land, Air, and Sea is Gameland Games' first big box game, and they knocked it out of the park. It's definitely a game that has that 4X feel as you're exploring, expanding, exploiting, and exterminating your opponents in the field of battle. You have this fantasy civilization, which is a cool fantasy race with tons of different special abilities. There's very asymmetrical play with the different abilities you have on your board and then the abilities that you have of your different heroes, and you can definitely play very differently with the different styles of fantasy characters that there are. We're trying to build up the civilization and go out and explore, flipping over those cool tokens with different events that can happen. Most of them aren't really too negative as long as you're prepared for what could happen on them. And then also you're trying to gather the resources from all the different locations on the board and then use those resources to upgrade your civilization, put more units out, build buildings to give you more special abilities and unlock your heroes and vehicles. And then you're also trying to like spread out a little bit maybe into your opponent's area and attack your opponents on different fronts so that way you can gain a little bit of an edge and maybe be able to take them out and do the conquest thing as you're messing up your opponents. It definitely is really cool in the combat of this game because you have this hand of cards. It's very deterministic. It's like, what's my points versus their points? And then you have these cards that are like Rochambeau or rock, paper, scissors on which ones work good against which things. But you can kind of tell what your opponent can play with the different resources that they have and maybe the different units that they're playing with. Maybe they're going to play a specific card. So you can be like, okay, well, I'm going to play this one because I feel like they're probably most likely to play that one, but they could play a different one. And it's very much like mind games with your opponent as combat goes on. I really had a ton of success in outthinking and outsmarting my opponents in that combat phase. And it just makes it super exciting because you never quite know what your opponent's going to play. And it's like you're on the edge of your seat flipping over that card, which is not something you normally get from like flipping over cards in combat, but it's very exciting in this game. It's definitely an awesome game if you want that 4X feel, but in a short time frame. I've played so many of these 4X games that take forever, all day long to play, but this game gives you all of that feeling without all the, it's not watered down at all. Like, it's very like intense on the civilization that you're building up, and it feels like you're doing something as you're playing the game, which is super exciting. And it's just a ton of fun to be able to build up something that it feels like you made your own, playing the game the way that you want to play it. So I love Heroes of Land, Air, and Sea, if you can't tell by how excited I am. This game has been a blast to play. I've played it over and over. My friends have actually made fun of me for playing this game like too much. They're like, hey man, do you like any other games more than Heroes of Land, Air, and Sea? This game immediately shot into like my top 5 games of all time. That's how much I love this game. So this game is amazing in my book. If you're at all interested in 4X games, make sure to check out Heroes of Land, Air, and Sea. The only downside to this game is that the constructs, although they're extremely awesome, you have to spend a lot of time punching that stuff out and have to be very careful as you do it. So if you do get the game, make sure to take extra care and set aside the time to be able to build the constructs perfectly.
And if you're a person that's not into confrontation or doesn't like when other people trample on the things that you built up, this might not necessarily be the game for you, because there's a lot of back and forth in the combat, which I love, and it's super exciting as you're engaging with other players, but you can play the game without combat and totally win the game as well. So as long as you're able to negotiate with your opponents to stay off, or you hold your defenses strong enough, you could never attack a single person and still come out on the very top. So it's definitely a game that can reward flexibility and playing to what your opponents are doing, making sure you're being defensive enough on all different sides so that they can't get you, or going out there and raiding your opponent's lands. I love Heroes of Land, Air, and Sea. If you haven't checked it out yet or haven't looked at it, the miniatures are beautiful. The game just looks amazing on the table. Huge table presence. And I definitely want to play this game with anybody that I get a chance to. So make sure to check out Heroes of Land, Air, and Sea. It's awesome. And if you like this kind of game, make it happen. So that was my review of Heroes of Land, Air, and Sea. And we'll see you guys next time.
Thanks so much for watching the Dice Tower videos. Find more great videos and reviews, as well as our top-rated audio podcast at Dicetower.com. You can also find other great shows at Dicetowernetwork.com. I'm Eric Summerer, and you've been watching the Dice Tower. The Dice Tower is sponsored by Cool Stuff, Inc., where you can find great games for great prices. Cool stuff in stock. Check them out at CoolStuffInc.com.